morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, that's better. Stand with us this morning as we enter into worship. Blessed be your name.
Join me if you would.
worship with us today. Just a few reminders for us coming up next Sunday. During this same worship hour time, we will be having Allison Spear. And Allison is part of the Gaither family worship team that travels around the country. And you will not want to miss that inside of your bulletin.
Inside your bulletin.
Yes.
Hi. This coming Sunday, Allison Spear, incredible singer, incredible happy lady. She's down to earth. She could be one of your sisters.
Yeah.
Well, here's what I want to do. I'll have this ticket here, and it's just a reminder. There's no pricing or anything. It's all free. But if you, I'm gonna fold it in half here. And what I'm gonna do is, you're still friends, aren't we? Except when I come to interrupt you.
Okay.
I'm gonna give you this half.
Thank you.
That way you can keep it as a reminder, and I'll keep this one as a reminder.
Okay.
And
awesome.
So you have a couple more tickets.
I do.
Maybe you can give those to a couple friends and remind them as well.
We'll do it.
Okay.
There you go.
Down.
There's our advertisements. So you don't want to miss that. Invite friends. It'll be a really, really good time. And also coming up, our children's quiz will be traveling in 2 weeks from yesterday. We'll be traveling down to Apopka, which is near Orlando, for their district quiz meet. Be praying for our kids because it's a good year to do well in Bible quiz competition, because if they place higher up, then they will get to go to the world quiz this summer, which is in Indianapolis, which would be really cool if we could send some quizzers there. We're looking forward to that. And also there's a listing for our Holy Week services in the bulletin. You won't want to miss any of those. They're always very, very special. And we thank you for that. Our teens will be going to Trevecca soon for TNT, Top Nazarene Talent. So be praying for them as well, and be willing to maybe sponsor some of our kids if they need help with that. We could use your assistance with sponsorships. If you're interested, let us know. If you are a first-time guest with us this morning, there are some cards in the pew in front of you, and we would love it if you would take one of those and fill it out and drop it in the offering plate as it comes by this morning so we could get to know you better. And it's really good to see some friends that pop in now and then, and we're glad that y'all are here today. Our own kids are back for a Sunday. We're glad to see some of them back, all of our college kids. You must be on spring break.
I was.
Yeah, good. Okay, well, good. Well, it's good to see you. And this morning, would you stand and greet one another?
I'm sorry.
receive this morning's tithes and offerings. Thank you again so much for being here today. Bonnie wanted me to let you know that after you graduate from this side, you can move to this side. Amen. So glad you're here. Hey, a couple prayer requests. We have some folks on the prayer list that are not doing well, and a lot of them are sick today, too. But one of them, Peggy Mann. Peggy, a lot of you may have just started to meet her. She's been here a few Sundays, and then she's had pneumonia over the past two Sundays. So she cannot seem to kick this thing, and pray for Peggy. If you don't know her, just remember her name. The Lord knows who she is. Also, Libby Lane, who typically sits over here with her husband, George. Libby has had an eye surgery, and from the eye surgery, there was a little snafu, the thing that happened, and so she had a little surgery on her eye, another area wasn't planned on. And so that's kind of healing. But pray for her. If you've ever had a cataract surgery, you'll kind of know what she's going through. She still has blurriness. She's not able to drive to work, and she's an executive in her business that she leads. And so she heads up Tallahassee Lenders Consortium, and so it's important for her to work. It helps people a lot through housing and so on through Tallahassee. So pray for her as well. And if there's someone you're missing today, would you do me a favor? When you go home today, call them, email them, or write them a text message and say, I missed you. I prayed specifically for you today. And or whatever you might want to write, God lays on your heart. As our ushers could help us today, thank you so much for your faithfulness and being here today. In the United States today, these time changes is the the worst attended day in any church in America. And I think if we could just pray real loud today, we could reach their bedrooms. I'm sure we're still there. Amen. God bless you. Let's pray together today. Our Father, we really do thank you for your presence in our lives this very day. We thank you that you've come to allow us to enter into your time of worship, to preparing our hearts. And the joy of the Lord be in our strength. We thank you for a privilege of worship and giving. And we pray for these who have these needs today as well. We thank you for those who give and those who can't give. Father, most importantly, we're thankful for those who have surrendered their hearts completely to you. And those that are here today that are battling some frustrations in their life, that's why we're here at church. We don't have perfect people and actions, but we have people who believe in a God who can change our hearts and lives forever. So today, bless all of your children here in this area, in the nursery, and the children's church area. May this be an incredible day in the life of your church here at this location. In Jesus' name, amen.
catching my breath before I try to sing.
Oh, Holy Spirit rain down. Amen. When Jesus was leaving the earth, before he left, he had told his disciples that he would send another comforter when the time came. The Bible says that in Acts 1:11, he ascended into heaven, and the angels have called out and said, "You men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into the heavens? This same Jesus which was taken from you will one day return in the same manner." In the meantime, 10 days after that period of time, Jesus had been on the earth for 40 days, and 10 days later after he left, there's something powerful started happening in the book of Acts. Jesus had told them in Acts 1, verse 8, that they would tarry and would wait, and the Holy Spirit would come and empower them, and they would be his witnesses. And to talk about, if you look at this same location where we are, we would be his witnesses in Tallahassee, state of Florida, across this country as we know it, and then across the world. The Holy Spirit of God doesn't just come when we call or sing or feel good or have warm fuzzies on the inside. When every believer, the child of God, has fully surrendered, when you have asked Jesus to come into your heart and life, when you come to a place and you say, "I confess that I have sin in my life, O Lord," and then repent of that, say, "Lord, I turn from that. I make a willful change away from that, and I'm going to put my full trust in you the best I know how." We don't just become mentally understanding that we have a salvation, but the Holy Spirit of God enters into the heart of every person who will call out upon the name of the Lord Jesus. The Bible declares that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will save. The word saved simply means not that the boogeyman was just chasing me, but it means that you're saved in the sense of what God has looked at. The word saved, a salvation, it means regenerated. It means to be made righteous in the sight of God. For every one of us, without the righteousness of God on us, we stand before a devil's hell, ready to be toasted forever, and there's nothing that God will do about it until we call out to him. That's why so many people live like the devil, but when they have pains and problems, they call out to God, "Oh God, help me!" And the good thing is, God loves you so much that he sent his only begotten son, Jesus, to die for our sin. And it's like we're the type of people that will go out and live like the world and do everything we think we're supposed to do, but yet God still loves us. Friend, I need you to know this also. God is love. He is unconditional. Jesus is the example. But there's an accounting process that will happen for all of us. And it breaks the heart of God when his children go into outright willful sin. He doesn't want that for you or for me. But aren't you glad he loves you today? And not only do you need to know that he loves you, he's ready for you to love him back. And there are people in the world who love to walk around, if you will, like black pillowcases over their head, bumping into things in the world, kind of feeling their way around, like they're in spiritual blindness, thinking that they're doing the right thing. And yet, for whatever reason, they tend to avoid his word. They tend to avoid praying or talking to him, except when they have difficulties or problems. They avoid being around other people who kind of, they almost think, makes them feel guilty. It's like today, you might be thinking, "Why is he up there trying to make me feel guilty?" Sweetie, I am not trying to make you feel guilty. I have learned a long time ago that the Holy Spirit of God, I have no control over. And I'm thankful for that, aren't you? The Holy Spirit of God comes and convicts us and convinces us of the sin within our life. God does not choose or desire for any of his children of all of creation to ever sin. He wants all of us to come to an everlasting life, and that comes through a life of repentance and the empowerment of the Holy Spirit upon our life. This past month, we've been kind of looking at a theme called restart. And today in your worship folder, there's a simple little outline. There's some scriptures we may touch on as well. But the truth is this, the Holy Spirit of God is in charge of the service today, not me and not you, not the music, not anyone who has any input within this service. And if you will listen to the Holy Spirit of God speak to you in that still, soft voice. I had a person years ago ask me, he said, what does the still, soft voice of the Holy Spirit sound like? I said, well, maybe, let me give you an example that you understand pretty quickly. I said, what's that? I said, for example, to a teenager, I said, do you know when your mother or father, or maybe even both of them, could be standing behind you? I said, yeah, I think so. I said, are you sure? I said, are you really sure? And they said, they're standing right behind me right now, aren't they? And I said, no, but I just want to make sure you understood what it felt like. The Holy Spirit is there. The Holy Spirit doesn't come and smack us up the side of the face and say, you're dumb, you're stupid, you're pitiful. I can't believe you'd let the Father down. And I apologize if those words become offensive to you. But He does not come and just slap us around and belittle us. That's what humans tend to do because their love is not unconditional and towards one another. We tell sometimes people around us that we love them, but by our actions sometimes we kind of wonder. I do. I've kind of wondered at times, like my dad used to spank me when I was a little boy. I'd be in trouble. And I knew I was in trouble. And he said, I'm spanking you because I love you. And I said, I wished you didn't love me so much. He kept spanking, you know. Within our life, there are times we just simply need a restart from the Spirit of God. There's a story that reminds me of this about the lady named Gertrude. I wanted to say Geraldine. Well, let's just say Geraldine. She's here. Geraldine was the lady who was getting happy for some of you during the service a while ago. I better use Gertrude. She might think it's the wrong story. Gertrude is about to jump out of an airplane, a perfectly good airplane. She's taking lessons on how to parachute. And so while she's in the plane, the instructor reminds her and says, this big cord, when you jump, pull the big cord. If that doesn't work, I would have been off the plane before then, even if he said, if that doesn't work. He said, well, that doesn't work, pull the small cord. He says, and then there will be a red pickup down below that will be ready for you when you land. And so she jumps out, Geronimo! They should say, chocolate ice cream! Why say Geronimo? They just jump out there. She's floating down, and all of a sudden she sees the big cable. She pulls it. Nothing happens. So she pulls the small cord. Nothing happens. She says, well, that's kind of interesting. Now I'm kind of wondering if the red pickup truck's even going to be there for me. Sometimes, you know, you got to go to class. Sometimes you just need a restart. Sometimes you just need to learn it all over again. It's kind of like when you take your computer and it kind of freezes up on you. Sometimes it's because you've left it on for too long. Maybe you just need to do a restart. And often when I restart my computer, it knows what to do, works out all the bugs and the problems. Most often, if not, I call my son who knows what he's doing on the computer. So that's what I do. There was a church one day in the state of Illinois, and the church had just built this glorious complex, and they had a bell tower. And in the tower, they ran a little short of funds, so instead of putting the bell in, for two decades, for 20 years, the church, this big glorious church, had this steeple with no bell in it. Coming up onto the 25th anniversary, they raised enough money, and they felt like they should do something and put a bell in there. But the problem was they didn't know exactly what to do, and yet still, today, the news supposedly travels that you'll still not hear the ringing of bells from that church. And it's not because of the city ordinance. It's not because of the people complaining in the church that makes too much noise during service or something. And it's not because it plays hymns to remind people of certain songs or whatever it may be. The truth is that what they did, they bought this type of a facade type bell. And the bell doesn't have any clappers on it, so to speak. It cannot ring. It's made of rosin. And within our own spiritual lives and in the church, sometimes that's who we are if we're not careful. We put up this beautiful edifice, and everyone sees us and sees how we look, and we have the right look, and we may sometimes even have the right sound, but deep down inside, there's no spirit about our ring. There's no sound about who we are. And that's where the Holy Spirit of God comes in. Aren't you happy about that? He comes in and reminds us where we are. There's not one person in this room that cannot use the help of the Holy Spirit of God. In fact, I would venture to say I would be surprised if less than 80% of us here today would not actually stand and confess and say, I need a retouch, a restart of the Holy Spirit in my life. The truth is, it could be all of us, because all of us need to have a fresh start of the Holy Spirit on a regular basis, especially daily. You and I need to learn how to die out to self every day. Because unless we die out to self, that means that we don't just assume because we have the latest fads of clothing or the right kind of cars or homes or we have the right kind of jobs or position in this world that we're really looking good. Because before God, we're all stripped naked, in a sense. And we stand bare before Him. And He looks at our spirit. He looks at our heart. And only the hearts that are sponged. You know what a sponge does. When you take it, put it in water, and it absorbs all those drops. It's incredible. When you and I cannot squeeze, and we can't just touch the Holy Spirit, we do not conjure the Spirit up to come and just meet our needs. The Spirit moves on His own power, His own direction. And He comes to every heart who is open as a sponge and will be willing to allow Him to squeeze and fill you to overflowing. And the truth is, every one of us could use an infilling. So much of an infilling that we are dripping every time we walk. There's wet spots from our feet. That the Spirit of God, wherever we go, people can tell they must have been with Jesus. And people will sometimes even say, my life doesn't measure like yours. I need what you have. And it's only because we have a restart and we stay fresh on a regular basis. There's some questions that I want us to do some little soul searching on today. And some of them you'll find within the worship folder. But the first question I want to ask you, there's a couple of lead questions, and I have some, I call them sub-questions underneath. The first one is, do I need the Holy Spirit restart? In other words, is this even an issue for me? Am I already set? I mean, am I cool? I got it all together? My life is all ready, you know? The reality is, when you and I start asking some of these questions, maybe today the Holy Spirit of God will speak to you like He's already spoken to me. I already know what I need. I already told Him I need a restart. Just because I have this privilege of standing before you today and sharing this good news doesn't mean every day of my life I don't go through traumas or difficulties or frustrations, having people laugh at you or making fun or whatever may happen. Yeah, you need to have some thick skin, but part of that, there needs to be a tender heart, a tender spirit within us that we need to love, and we need to also at times even say what Jesus said while He was on the cross. You remember those words? He says, Father, in between the gasp that He couldn't hardly stand to catch His breath, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. Over in Acts chapter 7, it tells a story about Stephen. In Acts chapter 6, it talks about how he has tried to gather some leadership up and have a Spirit-filled people who love God. They're, so to speak, both palms. They're not holding the salvation in their hand. They're releasing and trusting Jesus, the Spirit of God, and everything within their life. And Stephen is one who's there. And there's a man who stands at his head at that time. His name was called Saul, and later his name becomes Paul in Acts chapter 9. And Saul, standing at the head of Stephen right after he had been stoned to death for being this Christian. You see, Saul was a person who simply was going to do anything he could to stomp out Christians. His calling in life, he thought he was being the religious person by the legal side of the law, that he would put out these Christians who were causing such a ruckus in the Middle East area. So Paul's mission was to go and stomp out and to kill these Christians, have them dead, these believers of Christ. Stephen, on his last part of his breath, he said the same thing he had heard undoubtedly Jesus mention. And while he was bleeding and broken from all the stoning, he says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And you flip over to chapter 9 of Acts, and all of a sudden, while there was this man, Saul, out walking on the road to Damascus on the way to hunt for some more Christians, the Bible declares that he's confronted with Jesus. A piercing light hits his eyes. He can't see. No, I'm not talking about like the story of the little boy who's walking with his mom in a thunderstorm, and he gets home and he says, Mama, did you see that? She says, what? The thunderstorm? No, that was God taking our picture. The light comes as a ray of light, and a shaft goes into his spirit. And the voice cries out and says, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul says, who are you, Lord? And from the confrontation and the communication at that time, Saul's name eventually becomes Paul, and Jesus calls him in to become one of the greatest, if not the greatest, missionaries of all existence in the Christian church. And Saul, who now become Paul, the Apostle Paul, he comes in, he's among around Christians. Think about this. If you had someone who had come in among us who were not a believer or someone we were comfortable with, and you knew in their life they were some of the meanest and the scummiest of people that you would not want to walk arm to arm with, you wouldn't go to dinner with, someone that you felt like, oh, I can't believe they're in this building. And yet that's who Christ has called us to reach. He's called us to reach people that no one else seemingly wants. Why do you think they're so mean at times? Because no one wants to play. They don't have any friends, I guess. So they have all their bad friends. But yet here the Apostle Paul comes in. And as I wrap this down, here's what happens. He comes in among the fellowship of the believers. The Apostle Paul, they see him as Saul, the condemner of the Christian. And they're all terrified. He said, I know what you're thinking, but I've had an encounter with Jesus Christ, and His Spirit has changed my life. And they're saying, hey, son, the proof is in the pudding. Let's see it. Put your money where your mouth is. We want to make people continually believe or to prove their worthiness before us, not before God. So Paul started demonstrating his life, and they caught on real quick. And as he walked, they had to run to keep up with the Apostle Paul. And the New Testament church took off, and they were first called Christians in Antioch. My friends, I'm here to tell you today, the Spirit of the living God has not stopped. It doesn't increase, doesn't slow down, doesn't coast. The Spirit of God is the Spirit of God, period. And then you and I live our lives any way we want to live them. He's going to speak to your heart. He's going to correct your path, and He's wanting to put you on the right path. Not that He hates you, not that He belittles you, not because He doesn't trust you. It's because He loves you. When's the last time you really had someone, you really had someone to tell you, I love you, and you knew it. You didn't have to look around to see if someone was watching. You just knew it. People who are married and they stand before a group of people, why is it that a man and a woman can say their vows to one another and take one another in a public course of simply of saying, I take this woman to be my wedded wife. I take this man to be my wedded husband. Till death us do part. And then at the end, although I get them to do this in rehearsal, they don't just go up and say, put her there, buddy. Shake hands on it. You can spit on the hand. Shake. They don't do that. The minister or the officiant simply says to the man, you may kiss your bride. That's the best part of the wedding right there. That you're not embarrassed to just smooch your sweetie right in front of everybody. But has that stopped in some of our lives? Because sometimes in our relationships, we kind of back away and we're almost nervous about what people are thinking. Well, it's no different in the Christian life. When you come to Jesus Christ and you confess your sins and you ask Him to come in your life, And then it becomes a place where you don't just know that you're a Christian or hope that you're a Christian, but without doubt, you know, even if your life and the last breath in your life, and you may be stoned to death or shot or hung on a cross, without question, you are His and He is yours. Like the man who sang that song one time, he said, I know it's real. He said, it's real, it's real, oh, I know it's real. Praise God, the doubts are settled, for I know it's real. And I hope that you know that without any question today. There's a lot of you in this room today, you're thinking, I am just on the top of glory land, and I thank God through the valleys that He takes me through and the rough places, because I belong to Him and He belongs to me. But there's a lot in this room today that are probably saying, I want to be on the top of the mountain. I want to have an exciting life. I want to have the joy of His salvation inside of me. But I'm fearful. I'm dreading this day. I don't want to go to work. I don't want to see my family. I don't want to be around certain people in the church. It happens. And that's kind of a signal why you need a restart of the Holy Spirit. You need to have a time that you get restarted and let the freshness of God come and restart your life. So the first question I would say is, am I eager to serve God? Romans chapter 7 verse 6 reminds us and says, but now we have been released from the law, for we died with Christ. We are no longer captive to its power. Now we can really serve God, not in the old way by obeying the letter of the law, but in the new way by the Spirit, or the Spirit of the law. Sometimes it's right to hold the letter and say, well, you didn't do this in church, Pastor. You should have done it this way and this way and this way. Well, bless your heart. Thank you for reminding me. That's the legal side of it. There's someone who always wants to point a finger at telling you what you're not doing right when they fail to see the three fingers back at them saying that they're not doing it either. It's always easy to judge, isn't it? You know? But why do we have to do that? Why not at the Spirit of the law? Just walk up to someone and say, man, that was the best I've ever been around. That was awesome. I had a professor one time, he would go out over the weekends, and he was at Mid-American Nazarene College at that time, now it's a university, south of Kansas City. And Dr. Larry Fine, maybe I shouldn't have said his name, but just in case, he would go out and preach on these weekends and had a good time doing it, enjoying and meeting people. He was always busy. And one day there are these people who always come out and bring their babies. And they'd say, oh, Dr. Fine, don't you just believe my baby's just as cute as can be? He says, now one Sunday there was someone came up and brought this baby, and it was the ugliest baby, he said. He said that baby had a big word across its forehead. It said, ugly, so to speak. He says, I wanted to tell him, but he says, I just didn't have the heart to say so. They said, well, what do you think of my baby? He went, oh, Lord, what do I say now? He says, like the Spirit of God came and said, say this. He said, now that's a baby. You have to listen. The Holy Spirit will get you out of trouble if you'll be careful. But am I eager to serve God? Sometimes there are frustrations within your life, but you got to be eager to serve Him. The second one is, am I enjoying time with God? Do I understand that my time of prayer, the time of in His Word? For like example, in Romans chapter 14, beginning at verse 17, it says the kingdom of God is not a matter of what we eat or drink, but living a life of goodness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. He says this, Paul writes this, if you serve Christ with this attitude, you will please God. So what is he saying? He's saying, if you just look at it, if you don't have a life of goodness, you don't have a life of peace, and you don't have a life of joy in the Holy Spirit, you're not going to please God. Nehemiah 8:10, I said it a couple times already. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Amen. Third question would be, am I growing in relationship with God? This is a great one. 1 Peter 2, verse 2 says this. You must crave pure spiritual milk so that you can grow into the fullness of your salvation. Here it is. Cry out for nourishment as a baby cries out for milk. I'm hungry! I don't know about your babies, our children, our three boys growing up, our grandchildren, the ones we've been around, people through the church. The children always let us know when it's time to eat. They let us know about a lot of things. And of course, we would grumble and complain. And Nita would say, it's your turn to feed them. Okay. Greg, I remember one night, she said, I gave the birth, you get the feed.
I don't think I said that.
Figuratively speaking. So I went downstairs, put on a saucepan, and let her rest. She needed that rest. Put the milk bottle, it was in a glass bottle at that time. You know what glass baby bottles are? Can I see a hand? You don't want to talk about. Some of you young ones, you're going, what's a baby bottle? Anyway, talk to these folks who raise their hand, they can tell you. Had this glass baby bottle, put just a few, I don't know, three little, not too much of water in there. Turned a small saucepan on, had a handle. We had a gas stove, so I had the fire burning in there. And I was in a hurry, so I could hear. I had good hearing, I think. What'd you say? And so I heard this water. I would wait for it to boil. But in the meantime, I was kind of tired. I mean, I'm a dad. I worked in the Air Force, and I was tired through the day. Sorry, you can't see me back there. So I just got easy in my chair. Oh, I just fell asleep a little bit. Wake me if I snore. All of a sudden, I had awakened. Maybe I woke myself up. I got up and I went, oh, I have to go get the milk. So I went in to get the pan and looked at the stove. The fires are burning. The pan is still there. The water is gone. The milk bottle is so hot from the heat, it's cut the bottom of the glass off. The milk has come into the pan. The milk is gone. I don't know how long I was asleep. And I took this pan. You know, if you hold metal in fire long enough, it gets kind of red. I went to the sink, being a young airman, thought I knew what to do and how to handle my life and the problems. And I was the man of our house and went and turned the cold water on and put that puppy. You know exactly what happened. Just the heat folded that metal pan and I cooled it down. The next morning, I threw it away before she could get up. Hey, went upstairs. It must have worked because the son was asleep. I went back to bed. That was it. It's a joy. It really is. It works out. But sometimes we have to have this craving. Like it says, this word crave, it means something I long for, something that I am willing to crawl out, cry out to for spiritual milk. When you're hungry, when you're thirsty, when you're out, maybe it's in sports, you're out running, you're jogging, some official game, volleyball, and you come in and you're just really breathing. You've been like, you just run half court, and you're out of air, and you're wanting some water. You know when you're thirsty, you know when you're hungry. You know when you're playing a game, you give it your very best. And you go get some water. Someone hands it to you. You're running a marathon. Someone tosses you a bottle of water. Why is that all important? Because you're craving. You're needing something. It's no different in the spiritual world, is it? We crave the Spirit of God. We need the things of God. We need the Word of God. You don't just need somebody on a Sunday morning or a Wednesday or sometime when the doors of the church are open. I thank you very much for being here today. But you can also read this for yourself. You can open the Word of God and let it come into you, and it eat on you, and you chew on it. And the good part of it, the Bible says, eat and you will be satisfied. You long for living water, He's got the answer. But you will not be fulfilled, you will not have any peace in your life until you crave Him and allow Him to fill you. Next question I would ask is, not only am I eager to serve God and enjoying time with Him, and am I growing in a relationship with Him, but am I a godly example for others? like the story about the little boy who's out on the beach. He walks up to this woman. He says, "Ma'am, are you a Christian?" She says, "Yes." He says, "Do you pray?" She nodded her head, "Yes." He says, "Do you read your Bible often?" "Yeah." He says, "Good. Will you hold my quarter while I go swimming?" You know, if you're a godly example, somehow things, that's a bad joke, but people, I think, recognize your walk with God. What do you think? Do people know that they can trust you? Let's just take God completely out of it. Let's just imagine for a second, because we can't live without Him, but let's say for a moment, God's not a part of our life. What kind of people do you hang out with then? What kind of influences are they putting upon your life? What kind of jokes do you go ahead and tell like they tell? Had a man one day, I worked for a security company. I was in between churches. It's a long story, and I won't tell you all about that. But I will tell you this. When I worked at this security company, it was for alarms, like a company for residential protection. And it was in the Atlanta area. Just a brief time I was there. And I came in on my second day, had a meeting with the sales manager. And while there was a break in the action for a moment, and the man who is the installation manager, that means that's the person who comes in and puts the hard boxes, the hardware, the computer panels on your wall, the buttons, the items, receivers and things off of your windows, and the motion detectors and so on. He comes in, and what he does is he starts telling this story. And when he tells his story, he gets up to this place, it's basically the story, he doesn't even know who I am. He just sees a fresh face in the room. And as he does, there's about 20, 25 people in this one little room. And he's just telling the story. And he's ready to get to the punchline and to tell the joke. And my good friend, he is now. At that first moment, he gets right to the punchline. He's about to demean and be the filthiest of words I have ever heard in someone's life. And my dad used to be a sailor. And I used to listen to him before he became a Christian. And my brother-in-law as well. And different people in my life. You know what I'm talking about, the language thing. But he was demeaning about these females that he was talking about. And all of a sudden, before he said the punchline, he stopped and he caught my eye. I didn't have glasses on at that time. I did not do, the look. I didn't do that at all. I'm just sitting there like, man, where's he going with this, Lord? I didn't have to say a word. He looked at me and saw my eyes, and he said, I have to go. "Oh, come on, man," they're all shouting out. "Tell us the rest of the story. You got to finish the story." He says, "No, I can't finish the story. I got to go." Went running out the door. Well, I didn't see Dwayne for a day, maybe 2 days. And I had to go by his office to get some information about, I had this address, I need to get this person, have information and items to be put in their home. And I said, "Can we schedule this on your calendar?" He said, "Hey, come on in." He says, what's your name again?" I said, "Dave." He said, "Hey, Dave, can you come in, shut the door behind you?" I said, "Sure, is everything okay?" He says, "I want to talk to you about something." Shut the door. Because he didn't want anyone to hear what he was about to tell me. And that's okay, isn't it? If someone wants to confess something to you, can you leave it behind the door and not spread it around? I shut the door. I said, "What's up, Dwayne?" He said, "About 2 days ago," he said, "I was telling this story, this joke, and I thought I'd get a big laugh, and I was wasn't thinking." He said, "Who are you?" That's all he said. He put his hand on. "Who are you?" I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "Well, I was wanting to tell that story, and I looked at your eyes, and are you a preacher or something?" I mean, he never even got his sentence out. I said, What do you mean?" He said, "Well, I looked at your eyes." He said, "Something stopped me." He said, "It's like God, the Holy Spirit, grabbed my tongue and turned me around and said, 'Get out of here.'" I says, "Well, Dwayne, I think from what I remember your story, you're a Christian?" That's what I did. I said, "Because I'm thinking if you were led by the Holy Spirit of God, would you really, Dwayne, should you be telling this kind of stories? Is that bringing honor and glory to God?" He says, "No, that's what I want you to forgive me for." He said, I've already prayed. I've already asked the Lord to forgive me. He said, I was completely out of line. He said, even though it's been like 2 days, he says, I want to first apologize to you. And I've already apologized to God and said, that's not who I am. He says, I go to church all the time. And sometimes you get around rough people who tell these type of things. He says, and you get caught up. He says, here's what I believe without any question. If I keep doing that, he says, my life will go down the tubes and go right to a devil's hell. I didn't bring any of it up. He brought it up. Actually, the Holy Spirit of God brought it up. You see, you cannot stop the conviction of the Holy Spirit of God. We cover it. We try to cover it with alcohol or smoking or sexuality. We try to go and turn the music up as loud as we can. We don't want to hear what's going on inside of our head. And the Holy Spirit of God is trying to pulsate and trying to speak to us. And we're hearing everything else because we don't want to be told what we must do. But if I am a godly example for other people, the Apostle Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 1, he says, and you should follow my example as I follow Christ. You see, if everybody in church followed you because of your Christianity, would they be following Christ or would they be following you? It's not about you and it's not about me. It's about Jesus. It's about being His example. And when you and I are His example in the world of darkness, the light just shines right out. You become that light that people don't want to see. In closing, I want to say this. The question pops up is, how can I restart? If you're looking for a quick fix, and you're hoping that today is something that will just kind of tide you through, you won't find it. I can't give you the answer. God can't give you the answer. Other than you have to talk to Him and say, here's where I'm at. I'd like to have a restart. I need the restart of the Spirit of God in my life. I need to be able to have Him to work in my life. And first, God, I want to restart in my commitment. I want to refresh my commitment to You, O God. David, the psalmist in the Old Testament, says in Psalm 51, in verse 8 and verse 10, he says this. He says, O God, give me back my joy again. You have broken me. You ever been to that place yet where God has broken you? And you know it's only He who has done that. But you know you don't have the joy that you used to have. I understand what that means. I've been there. He says, now let me rejoice. Create in me a clean heart, O Lord, and renew a right or a steadfast spirit within me. He says, renew me, O God. What's He saying? I need a restart. I need to be restarted by Your Spirit. I need to have something fresh because the people who are living godly around me make me feel convicted. If you and I have the same Spirit of God, we don't bring conviction upon each other. We bring encouragement. We bring confidence. We bring unfailing love. But if we're not living where we need to live, we know that. I remember as a young Christian in my young 20s, 100 years ago, I'd be sitting in a pew like you, and I'd see people who were, without question, Christian. Would you come just play some music for us? And they would get up, people who had been a Christian for 30, 40 years or more. People I would list with the letter S, capitalized, saints of God. And even though it didn't seem like one of those kind of services where you feel like you're being almost made to feel guilty, they sing Just As I Am, you know, 4,007 times, you know. They just have a simple song, maybe kind of like this. And they just get up and come pray. And that boosted me. That helps encourage me today to know that those folks back then, they didn't care what the people in the church felt. They came to honor and to worship their God, to serve Him, to thank Him for Jesus dying for their lives, and that they could just be found worthy to live this day for another day, that He would be lifted up, that all people in the world can know the same love that they had in their life. Didn't have to be an altar call. They just came and prayed. Friends, can I be honest? I miss that. I miss it. I miss seeing people just come to pray. It's like the pastor has to be the performer. Well, he didn't get so many people at the altar today. Or then there's a packed house and or people all around the altar, and they go, "Oh, pastor, that was the most marvelous message." Honey, I'm here to tell you, it's not about whether I'm performing correctly for you or not. The only person I'm here to please today is the Holy Spirit of God. And I pray that I've done what I'm supposed to do. But if it's been a while since you've had a restart, maybe you'd like to do that, because on the bottom of the inside of your worship folder, there's a little statement that I had printed out. And it says that you need to commit. Are you willing to even say this to Him? Are you willing to say that I love you, Lord? I want to restart. And you have to check yes, or you check no. If you say no, that means, you know, you haven't lost anything, you haven't gained anything. But if you say yes, you're saying in kind of your own spirit, you're saying, God, I want you to work in my life. But wouldn't it be an even better thing if you made a public confession of it? Why not just, if you want to do that, just where it says, Father, I commit myself to a Holy Spirit restart. Signed, Dave Pullen. But if you'd like to make your decision public, you're welcome to come and pray around the altar. I thank you for your time. I thank you for your listening. But most important, I pray that you'll listen to the Holy Spirit of God. He's not your enemy. The kingdom of God is at all work for you today. And it doesn't matter how old you are. Friends, none of us have arrived. And all of us fall short of the glory of God. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. Said while Christ was on the cross, that He even loved us while Jesus was dying for us. And Jesus is still seemingly have to prove Himself on the cross again. He's already done that, beloved. He said, it is finished. There is no other plan of salvation. And you can't come to God because you think you can anytime you want. The Bible says in John 6:44, you only come to Him when the Spirit of God draws you. And that's what He's doing here. He's drawing you today. If you're a Christian that's been here and you just need a restart, I invite you without prompting. I'm not going to beg you. I just want to ask you, do you need to come pray? Doesn't matter how long you've been a Christian. I just miss seeing Christians coming and pray. And if you're here today and you've kind of fallen off the wagon, so to speak, you've kind of backed away from God. You don't mean to. You just got kind of caught up in the system. You're just kind of doing what everybody else is doing because you kind of, like a blade of grass, kind of blend in. Maybe you'd like to come and pray this day as well. If you can't kneel at an altar, there's nothing powerful about it. It's just a piece of wood with some padding. And it's a great place that we believe in the church. I believe God meets us here. But if you can't kneel, I invite you to come sit on the front pew. But here's what happens. If you choose not to come, you've made a decision today. You've chosen to continue where you are. What would you like to do? Would you stand with me as we close out today? Friends, if you'd like to come and pray, I'm just going to pray a moment, quietly. I want you to bow your heads and just pray for a moment. Just bow your head. And if it's something that you'd just like to get a restart, why not come out today? Why not just let Him come and just help you out this very day? Thank you, Father, for this morning, this time we've just come to praise You. We've come to honor You. Today we're just saying, oh Lord, how much we love You. How much we need You. Thank You for the privilege of just being here today and being a part of all that's said and done. Lord, every one of us collectively in this sanctuary today, we all need Your power, the Holy Spirit of God upon our life. We're helpless. We're weak. We're anemic. Our attitudes come off wrong. The words we say so that we haven't meditated with you. Like in Psalm 19:14, you tell us, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. But if my mind is not stayed on you and my words are not like what you would be pleased with, then Father, my attitude will be soured. It'll be as bad as soured milk, and it doesn't taste good, I know. And a lot of people don't want to be around that. Sometimes our leadership, Lord, and all the business and world that we live in, our leadership gets challenged. And we almost kind of complain like a young teenager wanting their way. But Lord, I pray today, grow us up to be the men and women that you want us to be by being willing to become humble before you this very day. Thank you for these who have come to pray already. Lord, there may be some more who just want to come. May they come out right now, Lord. They're waiting for someone. I pray they will just step out. They'll just want to pray. And just say, oh Lord, I just want to have a fresh start with you. Restart my life. Let me be the example that you want me to be. I want to start today. I'm going to do it in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Folks around the altar, keep praying. Keep praying. Do you have words to this? Do we have words? Can we just do this real quick? Just think for a moment. Just a chorus or so, if we can get to the chorus. While these pray. Would you like to pray? Keep standing. We're not going to be here long, I promise. Just sing it. Just think about the words.
Rain down. Oh, comforter.
His joy will be your joy. Amen. God bless you. Shake hands with one another. You're dismissed.